Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Good evening. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the fourth lecture in the new series of the lectures of the organized by the Center for the Studying of the Islamic Manuscripts at Al-Furqan. It's a great pleasure. It's a great pleasure to have you all here tonight, and thank you for your attendance. As you have seen already in the invitations, tonight's lecture is entitled The Role and Originality of Late Arabic Scientific Commentaries. Before I give the floor to the keynote speaker, Professor George Saliba, I would like to invite Mr. Sharif Yamani, member of the Board of Directors of Al-Furqan, to say a few words, please.
Well, thank you, Sali. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all on behalf of our chairman, Sheikh Ahmed Zaki Yamani, and the board of directors to tonight's public lecture, held, by the way, for the first time in this lecture room. So it's nice to see it nice and full. I'm delighted to see many returning friends of the foundation and encouraged by the attendance of many new faces from various interests and cultural initiatives. In my role in the foundation, I've had the good fortune of meeting and working with the elite minds whom continue to help us find the missing pieces in our understanding of the Islamic civilization and its influence. And tonight, more so, I am privileged to welcome Professor George Saliba, whom honors us with his presence. His contribution throughout the years has been really a beacon of enlightenment, and I very much look forward to his lecture, and I'm sure you all do as well, so I promise to be brief. More than ever, it is important today to study the contribution of the Islamic civilization, especially in the fields of arts and science. Learning that one civilization has greatly benefited another and its progress can only bridge the gap of understanding and acceptance between both. To the West, it acts as a counter force against the phobic philosophy of division, or what some might call the clash of civilization. And to the East, studying the success of many before us will hopefully create the right role models and gradually inspire generations of thinkers and leaders to contribute, as we dearly need that these days. Innovators, inventors, and scientists who not only preserved the knowledge of their ancestors, but expanded their generation's understanding by producing original works in the field of science, philosophy, and art. A big part of the Al-Furqan Islamic Heritage Foundation and its activities is to unearth the physical quantities of these treasures left behind through our cataloging initiative. But we also endeavor to help spread the knowledge that it contains through several platforms and initiatives, including this public lecture. The best way to preserve physical treasures, like gold or manuscripts, is to store it in the right conditions and lock it up. But as our chairman always reminds us, the best way to preserve knowledge is to spread it. Therefore, part of our foundation's initiative under the umbrella of preserving our written heritage is to study and produce critical editions of manuscripts that hold an important position in history. The foundation has identified several disciplines to target, and I will not get into them, but the most important for this lecture is the discipline or the field of arts and sciences. In history and geography, for example, the foundation was privileged to work with Professor Ayman Fuad Sayyid to produce Al-Maqrizi's book Fi Al-Mawa'id Wal-A'tibar Fi Dhikr Al-Khitat Wal-Athar, considered by many one of the most important reference work on the history and geography of Egypt, written more than 600 years ago. In the fields of mechanics, we've published Isfizari's book in Arabic, Fil Athqal wal Hiyal, with the help of our dear friends, Professor Salim al-Hassani and Dr. Muhammad Abatoy. And we look forward to the English translation very soon, so we can host a book launch to commemorate and celebrate such an important project. The foundation has also worked tirelessly to promote the works of al-Hasan ibn al-Haytham, al-Tusi, and al-Khayyam, whom are all pioneers in the field of analytical mathematics and geography. And in medicine, and more precisely in the field of ophthalmology, the foundation produced two works, one of Abu al-Abbas al-Qaisi and his book, Natijat al-Fikr fi Ilaj Amrad al-Basar, a book written more than 800 years ago, and another project containing two manuscripts, Al-Mu'alijat al-Bukratiya and Firdaus al-Hikma by al-Tabari, written more than 10 centuries ago. Now, these projects and others in the fields of arts and sciences, as I mentioned, have been at the heart of our objectives and our progress in this foundation, and we look forward to continuing them in the future. Throughout the past 25 years, our public lectures have been a platform for distinct and engaging topics to be discussed and debated. Topics ranging from music and cuisine in the Muslim civilization, democracy in the Islamic political system, to the discovery of the House of Khadija more recently in Mecca, and I guess one of my favorites and close to my heart and my stomach, diet and health in 9th century Baghdad. Tonight we continue that tradition. And the podium and platform that hosted the likes of Ahmed Zaki Amani, Anne-Marie Shimel, Yusuf Ibish, and Ikmaluddin Ahsan Oghlo will add to that list of greats. But may I please advise you to put your seatbelts on, or if Sally didn't hand out any seatbelts, hold on to your seats, because Professor Saliba will not only take us back in time, but he promises through his topic to fly us up into outer space and then hopefully back again. I'm delighted to welcome you all, and may we always gather in good health and spirit and continue to flourish through learning and understanding. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sharaf. Respected guests, up to the present day, academic studies regarding the scientific thought produced in the Islamic civilization have focused on the first six centuries, up to the 12th century. Furthermore, there is a general impression that the golden age of the Islamic civilization in terms of philosophical and scientific production came to an end sometime around the beginning of the 13th century of the Common Era. The period that followed is supposed to have sunk that civilization into a continuous decline from which it has yet to recover. Features of that decline are usually exemplified by the production of commentaries instead of original works. Hence, the intellectual heritage accumulated between the 12th and the 19th centuries, the period considered as the late classical period of Islamic civilization, however, have not received the scholarly attention it deserves. Tonight's lecture will focus on the field of astronomy and will demonstrate that particular commentaries that were produced between the 13th and the 16th century did not only produce new scientific thinking, but also produced a level of astronomical mathematical sophistication that could outmatch any of the earlier works that were produced within the Islamic civilization, and could, in some instances, even outmatch the contemporary scientific works that were produced in Europe at the time. Our keynote speaker tonight on this topic is a distinguished guest. He came all the way from the States. He is one of the authorities in the field of the development of scientific ideas from late antiquity till early modern times, with a special focus on the transmission of astronomical and mathematical ideas from the Islamic world to Renaissance Europe. George Saliba is a professor of Arabic and Islamic science at Columbia University in the city of New York. He has occupied the position of distinguished senior scholar program between 2009 and 2010. His latest works include Islamic Science and the Making of the European Renaissance, History of Arabic Astronomy, Planetary Theories During the Golden Age of Islam, and more than 120 articles in scholarly journals, including Greek Astronomy and the Medieval Arabic Tradition, as well as more than 200 presentations at academic venues on 5 continents. The list of his contributions is very long. I can't read it all of that. Among his awards are the History of Astronomy Prize from Kuwait Foundation for the Advancement of Science in 1996 and the History of Science Prize from the Third World Academy of Science in 1993. I would like to thank Professor Saliba for coming all the way along and for being with us tonight. It's a great honor and pleasure, and I would like to welcome him on the podium to address this distinguished audience tonight. So thank you, Professor.
Thank you. It's very kind of you. Can you hear me, or I have to stand behind that microphone? You can hear me?
Yeah.
That is enough. That's all I need is that. Never mind the microphone, we will come back to it. But I need that little ticker here, and just, I'm going to test it now. It works perfectly, so that is okay. And I thank you very much, Mr. Shazbari. I also would like to thank Mr. Yamani. I also would like to thank Mr. Al-Hassani. These people are responsible for making it happen. So that's why I'm here, and I pay tribute to all of them. What I'd like to do is exactly continue with what Mr. Shahzebari has done by telling you that I'm always suspicious when a certain idea gets repeated very often, because then it means that people stop looking into the details and they begin to take ideas as accepted and so on. When I first began to read what are called commentaries, I was shocked by the amount of material contained in those commentaries, texts. And then I began to worry, why would somebody like Ibrahim Madkur, may his soul rest in peace, and I have tremendous respect for Mr. Madkur, but also we are all human beings and we are all very limited. And when Mr. Madkur wanted to speak about what happened after the so-called golden age of Islamic civilization, by the way, the book that you just quoted by the title, when I wrote a book in 94, I called it A History, not The History, A History of Arabic Astronomy, and then I called it Planetary Theories During the Golden Age of Islam, whereby I defined the Golden Age to happen to be in the post-Ghazali era, to happen after the 12th century, so that people will pay attention to what was written in that period and not dismiss them. The poor Madkur, as I repeat, with all my respect, and I met him personally and I love that man, but the late man was also limited by the knowledge that he had at this time, by the common idea that was repeated everywhere, that after the Ghazali and his commentaries began to appear, he came up with a judgment that says this. And listen, this was he was the head of the Cairo Academy of the Arabic Academy, like a very distinguished man. When he writes these things, people immediately take them for granted, and that's it. From there on, they begin to follow. He says, speculative thought, and I'm sorry to help you read it, was confined to increasingly narrow areas. Scientific inquiry stagnated. When you say that, it means nobody will look at a book that's written after the 12th century, and matters that had previously been studied and understood became obscure. Creative thinking and the spirit of discovery were replaced by sterile repetition and imitation expressed in commentaries and the duties and the studies of text and stressing words that rather than meanings. That is a condemning statement to a whole body of literature that grows after the 12th and 13th century. And by the way, I mean, in terms of manuscripts, the tons that were produced after that really outmatch anything that was produced before. Furthermore, I would say, Madkur was not alone in really thinking of commentaries after commentaries. All I had to do is go to Google, by the way, just write the phrase, commentaries upon commentaries, and you will see the kind of garbage that comes from the internet. And most of it, by the way, to characterize Islamic civilization after the 12th century. They say they produced nothing except commentaries upon commentaries and so on, and hence repeating almost what Madhkur has said innocently, I think, at the time, and in a general context in the 1960s when we didn't know as much as we now know. So he was not alone. Nobody was to blame him for that. And what I plan to do tonight is, this is the conclusion. If you really don't like it, you can leave. I will demonstrate, by the way, how such assessments stem from self-fulfilling prophecies. By that I mean, if we are in a mindset that says nothing original was written after the 13th century and a book laid on my desk written after the 13th, I will skim through it. I will not really read it in detail. But I hope I will teach you tonight. I will go with you to see how to read books in detail so that you will see the novelty in the detail rather than just the general title, as most people do. And unfortunately, most catalogers miscatalog, as we will see, even original texts get lost. And to illustrate things, I never really wanted to make a single statement that does not have a page from a manuscript to back it up. I am tired of people saying Arabic civilization produced every single thing. I've asked them, what is it in particular? And they have no idea. But the idea is that we should be documented, and I plan to document with you tonight why I claim that after the 12th century, the best astronomy ever produced in the Islamic civilization was produced after the 12th century. Not in the Ma'mun and Bayt al-Hikmah and all of the stuff that he keeps repeating at boredom. And we are all nauseated by this. We've had enough. But in the later periods, there are very original material, but you will see why it is difficult to study. I will go on. I want to put a specific astronomer that very few people know him, by the name of Shamsuddin al-Khafri. How many people knew of Khafri, by the way? Okay, but that is because you read too much. Anybody else? No. You see, this Khafri was born again in an almost incognito city, little Khafr, that people don't even know whether it is the Khafr that is close to Shiraz or the Khafr that is closer to Firuzabad. Nobody knows where he was. He was little of no importance. And he is not among the list of very important names, by the way, that we have to look at. Turns out, I want you to see what this man inherited and what he did. And starting with the text, I know there is a pointer in this one. It is the top one. Starting with the famous text of the Bible for astronomers by the name of the Almagest, written by Ptolemy, the Greek Ptolemy, and the text was translated from Greek into Arabic several times during the early 9th century and so on. But that text became a beacon for other people to try to understand it. And hence, I will take you through a trip and show you that in the process of commenting on the Almagest, Nasiruddin al-Tusi of the 13th century, well beyond Ghazali, by the way, so he's still beyond Ghazali, produced what is called Tahrir al-Majesty. And one day, I think, I would like you to invite me back again to actually give a whole lecture on what does the term Tahrir mean vis-a-vis Sharh, vis-a-vis Islah. Because these technical terms, people use them and to signal something, and hence not to be dismissed just Tahrir is just like Tahrir al-Majalla and Tahrir this, because we use modern colloquial Arabic parlance to understand things. Unfortunately, the language and the level of the understanding has gone so far down that we are nowhere close to the original intentions of those great minds that actually could distinguish what is the difference between a Tahrir and Islah and the Sharh and the Tafsir. All of these terms are rich in their background. But I will show you what Tusi did when he produced Tahrir al-Majesty. And here I give you a lead. All the arrows that you see them in red, they mean they were written as a commentary on the previous text. The arrows that you see them in blue, it means out of the commentary, new ideas were coming out, meaning creative thinking was coming out. From the Tahrir, we can see that Tusi produced a tazkira in which he actually produced a new material that is not neither known in the Al-Majest nor known in the Tahrir al-Majesty. And then Tusi himself, his tazkira, produced as commentaries, Sharh al-Tazkira by al-Sharif al-Jurjani, who, again, well beyond Ghazali, that's 1413, and Qutb al-Din al-Shirazi, a student of Tusi, produced two commentaries. One is called Nihayat al-Idraq fi Dirayat al-Aflak, the other is called al-Tuhfa al-Shahiyya. Again, a question. I gave it to a student of mine, and he wrote a PhD dissertation on it about 3 years ago. Why would an astronomer produce actually three commentaries on the Tazkira all within a period of 3 years? And each commentary is about 250 folios. That's, for those who don't know what a folio is, 500 pages. And then three in Arabic and one in Persian. And all within a period of 4 to 5 years. Why? What kind of fire was building in his belly to feel that he really needs to say all of these things and explain them in great, great detail? But between the two, the Nihaya that he wrote on Nihayat al-Idrak and al-Tuhfa al-Shahiyya here, you notice in from the Nihaya, he produced something new that he puts it in the Tuhfa. And that's why the blue arrow is in here. Khafri, as a matter of fact, comes to the work of Tusi through the layer of the commentary of al-Tazkira, and in which he wrote his own At-Takmila li Sharh al-Tazkira. That is the commentary on the commentary, but there is a reason why he did that. And then he comes to it also from the Nihayat al-Idrak. He comes at al-Tuhfa, the new things that came from the Nihaya into the Tuhfa. He puts them in another book that he calls Muntaha al-Idrak fi Dirayat al-Madrak al-Aflak. So you could see he's punning on the sources that he was deriving from. Both of these, the Takmila fi Sharh al-Tazkira and the Muntaha al-Idrak fi Dirayat al-Aflak, produce something that is absolutely new, that is called Hal ma la yanhal. If I translate this to English, it will blow your mind. It's saying it is solving what is irresolvable, meaning the kind of mathematical problems that astronomers have thrown their hands up in the air and say, I can't solve it. Khafri comes and says, there is a solution. And that solution, he says, despite the difficulties, I can show you how it can be done. And his works, actually, this last book, the Hal Ma La Yanhal, is, in my estimate, the best book in astronomy, in theoretical astronomy, ever written in any civilization, not only Islamic civilization. This is a man who resolved all the problems of astronomy and put them in a very small, as you will see, but very, very hard to read, very small, 20 folios or so. But it was sufficient to juice all the brilliant ideas and put them in that one book. And I want to introduce you to the kind of work that this man did. Starting with the Al-Majest and its commentary in the Tahrir al-Majesty, and I'll give you a taste of what these commentators were doing. Nasir al-Din al-Tusi actually wanted to use the Al-Majesty to make it a textbook. For anybody who has not read the Al-Majest, by the way, I advise you to read it, even in English. Not to be to become astronomers, but even to just get an idea of how difficult the text is. And it is definitely not a usable textbook. So Nasir al-Din says, I want to make it a usable textbook, and decided to write the Tahrir on it. And here he tells the stories on how the Ptolemy deals with the latitudes, with the longitude of the planets, how what are the spheres, and how the Aflak plays with this, and so on. And then he reaches this section here, where he tells you how Ptolemy actually configured the movements of the planets in latitude. Immediately, in the middle of the discussion, Tusi becomes now not a commentator anymore. He becomes an author. And what does he say? أقول هذا كلام خارج عن الصناعة. For those who don't know Arabic, this is the most polite way of saying this speech is good for cocktail party conversations. This is not the kind of speech an astronomer should actually talk about. And he goes on to say why this is خارج عن الصناعة. It's just like cut it out. But how else could he say that Ptolemy is full of nonsense? In this particular point, he admired Ptolemy. He spent 250 pages explaining what Ptolemy was doing, but then he says, now it is unbearable. This speech is kharij an as-sina'ah. But he doesn't stay there and say, that's enough, I don't like to read Ptolemy anymore, and goes home. He says, no, my duty is to fix it. And to fix it, he says, I can actually fix it by pointing to this new theorem that he designs here for the first time. It's not known in the Greek text. It's not known in Ptolemy. This theorem is in purpose of it is to say that I can produce linear motion as a result of two circular motions. It might, you know, strike you as something, so what's the big deal? Remember, I tell you, every time you run your car, there is a piston that goes up and down. That is linear motion. It goes up and down. But that up and down translates into your wheels running on the road. Otherwise, without this kind of fundamental relationship between up and down, steam engine did exactly the same thing, by the way. It was up and down, but then it is to turn things around. That theorem, it changed the way we look at things. And again, I can give a whole 1 hour lecture on what did that theorem do to the Aristotelian conception of the difference between circular motion and linear motion. For those who know Aristotle, and at least I know one here, who knows Aristotle intimately well, when he divides the world between the world of linear motion of contrary and hints going into corruption and decay, and in the world that is permanently divine and goes into circular motions. And here comes Mr. Tusi, says, ha, that kind of division is nonsense because I can produce one from the other and vice versa. When with this theorem that is proposed here for the first time, and notes the dates from now on. 1247 he was writing this, and he was writing it again in a context of commenting on Ptolemy. It is not the place where he had the full freedom to expose his own ideas yet. Sure enough, as soon as he did that, 10 years later, he realized that this theorem is very fecund. Not only does it have the technological applications that I just told you about, it has theoretical foundations too. And then he said if he wished that he could have a video camera shots, by the way, he wanted to show us how the movements, the circular movements of one sphere going this way, the inner sphere going in the opposite direction at twice the speed, will make this point move up and down along the diameter of the. So he gives us 4 video shots for it, but that's the best way he could do. All right? And then he takes the theorem and proves it in general. He says, if I take any sphere represented here by the equator, and he says, if I take the inner sphere tangent to it at the beginning like that, allow the outer sphere to move by one angle, the inner sphere by twice that angle, then this point, H, they call it Ha here, will oscillate up and down along Alipa. So not only does he conceive of a theorem, he gives it the rigorous proof, the geometricians will accept, and the mathematicians will have to tip their hands and say, indeed, now he can prove that actually linear motion can be produced from circular motion. Who comes about 200 years later? I advise you to look at the dates. Tusi formalized that theorem in a treatise that he called the Tazkira, wrote it in 1259. Copernicus picks up exactly the same theorem, but Copernicus lives after Tusi by about 250 years or so. And for the same purpose, Copernicus says, we need to get linear motion out of circular. He calls it libration in the Latin text. And this, by the way, this text is taken from the Latin printed version, but his own manuscript version keeps the text and exactly the same lettering as well. One addition, if you just compare this text to this text, you notice that there is this addition of an imaginary circle, which is nothing but the path of the center of this one. As it is moving, it will draw this circle around, which is imaginary circles are not useful. We need the real circles that are representing spheres, and that's how Tusi does it. But the late Willie Hartner, may his soul also rest in peace. I don't think I mentioned him here. Yeah, no, I mentioned him. The late Willy Hahn, he died in 1981, I think, or 82. He compared the two and noted something very clever. He says, look, the Arabic has Aleph, the Latin has A. The Arabic has Ba, the Latin has B. The Arabic has Dal, the Latin has D. The Arabic has Jim, the Latin has... He says, what the heck is going on? If I ask you to draw a triangle ABC, you put ABC wherever you want. Why are they being put in exactly the same position that Tusi had put them, and even on top of it, make a mistake? For example, in the Arabic here, they have a Zain, because Arabic goes Abjad Hawaz, by the way, not Alif Bet Atha. The mathematicians and astronomy use Abjad Hawaz. So the Zain is much closer. And you all know, those of no Arabic, the Zain and the Fa in the manuscripts are very, very similar. So somebody who was helping Copernicus actually read this Zain as an F, and he read it as a Fa. Every single other point is exactly the same point that Tusi had put it there in the first place. So not only did Tusi, in the context of commenting on Ptolemy, in his Tahrir al-Majesty, introduce a new theorem, he introduced the new theorem that becomes very fecund, very productive for the Renaissance father of astronomy, Copernicus himself. See? So when we see the influence and the production of the new material that is going through the commentary, at least, we should pay respect to the commentators and say those guys were not trivial. They were really thinking as they were writing their commentaries. They say, Aqul, stop. You can't continue with this text. And now he interferes in the text as we have seen. We'll see Khafri do something much more brilliant than that. Now I will come, once we see the influence of the Tahrir on the Tazkira. The Tazkira, we see it now, comes into the Sharh, and again, several people wrote on it, and then the Takmila of Khafri. So I'm going to take you onto these productive roots of the commentaries as we see. Here what you have is the text of Shamsuddin al-Khafri, that he calls it At-Takmila fi Sharh al-Tadhkira. And notice from now on, he begins to be exactly, by the way, like a Quranic commentator, like a Faqih commentator, like any commentaries written in the culture at all, meaning you write the words of the Musannif, as you see here, Al-Maqsad, Bil-Maqsadid, A'anah, As-Samad, Al-Ma'bud, Qala Al-Musannif, and then he superlines them. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this is from Tusi. Then he continues. Now you can jump the text of Tusi, you can read it all the way by only the superlines thing, and the material in between is the commentaries of the commentator, which is normal with the tradition, as the tradition has actually produced them. And now, notice what he wants to say here. I think I have a bigger slide. It will explain this better. So he says why he did it. He said, I wanted to write this commentary. And he says, مُدْرِجًا فِيهِ أَلْفَاضِ الشَّرْحِ الَّذِي أَلَّفَهُ سَيِّدِ الْمُحَقِّقِينَ وَسَنَدِ الْمُدَقِّقِينَ تَيَمُّنًا بكلماته الشريفة وبياناته اللطيفة. You see how polite these people. They were giving credit, but then he doesn't want to mention him by name. The names are a little gross. So he mentions him by the titles. He gives him his Mudaqqiq, his Sayyid, but then he gives you hints. And look at this commentator on the margin. He says, لَعَلَّ الْمُرَادِ. Perhaps, he says, he means by السيد المحقق السيد الشريف الجرجاني, because that's his name. His name is Sayyid and his Sharif is... So he says, كلماته الشريفة, to hint to you that this is a Sharif. And that is here as Sayyid, then you should get the meaning. And then he says he's doing this because he wanted to take it as a barakah. He will take it as a tribute to the people he is learning from. We wish our students do the same thing. When you take something from somebody, you should pay them thank you. You should make a remark that they were really the ones who led you into this new idea. And then he says, وَسَمَّيْتُهُ التَّكْمِلَ فِي شَرْحِ التَّذْكِرَةِ, so that you know what he is doing. He knows that the شَرْحِ التَّذْكِرَةِ is deficient. Now he wants to complete it. And he says, التَّكْمِلَ. And then he says, أَوْرَدْتُ, as you see here, فِيهِ مَسْتَنْبَطْتُهُ مِنْ كُتُبِ الْقَوْمِ مِنَ الْفَوَائِدِ مَعْ مَسْتَخْرَجْتُهُ بِقَرِيحَةِ الْقَاصِرَةِ. See the humility, what these people are saying. He says, I produced it by gathering what other people have already said about it, but on top of it, I also included what I istakhrajtuhu, that I stambattuhu, that I came up with, I created it afresh, bi qarihati al-qasira, min al-zawaid wahya qawaid. He said, these things that I add them now, they will become fundamentals for astronomy as we will see them later on. So with total humility, this guy expresses the originality that he is going to embed in his text, and he tells you ahead, so watch out as you are reading. You are going to meet all those new novelties, and then, of course, as we see them, he does. And then, as he is reading, and that's the full, you know, the function of a good commentator, that is to answer the role of the commentators, and then the originality in them. He reads the original text of Tusi, and what does Tusi say here when it comes to the planet Mercury? Anybody who knows a little bit of astronomy, including, by the way, Copernicus, when he dealt with the planet Mercury, he said, it is the one that befuddled me most. It is the most difficult planet. Why? Because it's so close to the sun. It is rarely observable. So you really can't have good data from of Mercury. So he obviously struggled with it. And what did Tusi say when he reached the planet Mercury? He says, أَمَّا فِي عُطَارِدْ فَلَمْ يَتَيَسَّرْ لِي بَعْدُ ذَلِكَ كَمَا يَنْبَغِي. He says, I have not solved the problems of Mercury as I should. But, he continues to say, if I ever do it in the future, I will place the solutions in this place in the book. But he died without ever finishing it. But for a commentator, this is like teasing him to say, come on, do something better. And then Khafri indeed uses this occasion to say that here Tusi failed. But let me tell you how, in the same way, Tusi had said, Ptolemy failed, and this is how I can fix him. Now Khafri says, Tusi failed, and let me tell you how I can fix him. And he goes on. And he says, وَلَمَّ وَأَنَا لَمَّا تَأَمَّلْتُ فِي كَلَامِهِ عَلَى التَّقْدِيرِ الْمَذْكُورِ ارْتَفَعَ نِقَابُ الْحِجَابِ بِعِنَايَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. You can see what a commentator, pious commentator nevertheless, he is struggling, and he knows that new ideas, you struggle, you sleep. And by the way, anybody who studied geometry, I am absolutely certain you've experienced it at one point in your life. In your sleep, you solve geometric problems, by the way. And he keeps thinking about it, keeps thinking about that. And then he says, in the final vision, you see the solution. It is just like somebody lifts the veil from your eyes, very similar to the Sufi language. The Sufis were saying the same thing. When they finally come to the blazing reality of the divine, it is just like the hijab has been lifted, and you see. So he says, then that when I, all of this, I ارتفع النقاب, I began to find the solutions for Mercury, and then أحدها, he begins here, number one. And the number one turns out to be this kind of mathematical construction. This is the way Ptolemy has conceived the movements of Mercury. This is how, now Khafri says, none, this is nonsense. Neither Ptolemy got it right, nor Tusi got it right. This is the kind of mathematical vector connections that you should do to be able to get it. Huh? Is this stagnant astronomy, repeating commentaries after commentaries? This is someone who is producing first novelties, and this is, I only give you the drawings so that visually you can see the tremendous contrast between them and the complexity that is implied in the comments that Khafri has put into it. Then he goes on, وَثَانِيهُمَا. So it is not only one solution. I have another, noch eins. Look, this solution too is much better, he says, and solves the problem better than that of Ptolemy. And then he goes on, and he says, وَثَالِثُهَا. Look at that. By the way, from now on, when he goes, أَحَدُهَا, ثَانِيهَا, I will repeat them back so that you will get to see what it is. He stopped the underlining. You notice there are no more lines from Tusi. Now he is at the stage of أَقُول. Now I say something new that was not in the original of Tusi, and now I am adding them one after the other. وَثَالِثُهَا وَرَابِعُهَا. Here, when he gets the fourth one, he says, وَهُوَ لِبَعْدِ الْمُتَأَخِّرِينَ. It's not his. but he wants to pay tribute to somebody else. You see, they're honest. He doesn't want to steal it. He could have done it, you know, like most people would do nowadays, shove it in and then begin to think that it's his production. We will see what he did with this novelty that he brought it from somebody else. This Ba'd al-Mutaakhirin, by the way, I determined later on that is nothing but a man by the name Ala al-Din al-Qushji, who worked before Khafri by about 50 years or so, and we have his text, we know why he got it, why it was a brilliant solution. This is the brilliant solution of Qushji as we have it here. So it gets incorporated in the works of Khafri. Altogether now, what Khafri is doing, he's saying, look, Ptolemy had this poor configuration on how the planet Mercury moves, and it is wrong. Wrong, cosmologically wrong. Not wrong because it doesn't predict where the planet is. It gives a very good approximation where the planet is. But it rests on physical, cosmological ideas that are self-contradictory. And I'll give you the example of how contradictory they are. Have you ever seen a basketball player take the ball and twist it and put his finger in and the ball continues to spin on his finger? That means a ball moving in space at regular speed through an axis that goes through its center. But if that finger is not pointing to the center, that ball will not be able to move. Ptolemy, in his configuration, he proposes those balls moving on spheres, on axes that don't go through their centers. So he says this is physically impossible, you cannot do that. Hence, you need to account for them by creating spheres that move properly like spheres and move their centers as they should, hence cosmologically coherent spheres and not self-contradictory. And then he says, I have one solution, as you see here. Where is one? Number one should be somewhere here. I have, this is the second model. He said, this is the first, the second, the third, and the fourth model. He has four different ones. Keep that in mind. I want you to ask yourselves now, if you have solved the problem once, why do you need to solve it again? Why do you need to solve it a third time? Why do you need to borrow from somebody else a fourth solution if you were not thinking that mathematics does not contain in it, does not embed the truth, capital T, underlined the. Mathematics is only a descriptive language. It tells us something about the physical nature. And I'll give you another example. Point A can be connected to point B by an infinity of vectors, all of them going between A and B. So there is no limitation of one. Why should one be preferred to the other except for extraneous circumstances? So Khafri now is saying you can use a multiplicity of mathematics to solve these fundamental problems, and he goes on and produces five of them. Now I come to the next text of Khafri, where we had finished what he had done. Oops. What he had done in Sharh al-Tadhkira of Sharif al-Jarjani in the Takmila. Now he leans back onto Qutb al-Din al-Shirazi, where the Tuhfa had included some new ideas from the Nihaya, but still had problems of their own. So he writes on it, Muntaha al-Idrak fi Madrak al-Aflak, echoing this, but at the same time commenting on this one. What does he do with that? Look what he did. He takes it, he says, now, instead of saying, I want to follow the wordings of a Sharif al-Jurjani, here he says, an atatabba' fi alfaz al-tuhfa al-shahiyya. He tells us where is his source of inspiration. And he takes it, and this is again, you see, he doesn't have any drawings in these, no underlinings anymore. Now he's talking, and then he says, فَسَمَّيْتُهُ مُنْتَهَى الْإِدْرَاكِ فِي مَدْرَكِ الْأَفْلَاكِ. And here it is poorly preserved, but I can read it for you. And then he goes on to say, when he reached the planet Mercury, now he said, I have five solutions. If you thought that four solutions in the Takmila were too much, now I'll give you one more. Hence, he is now showing that mathematically speaking, you can really, there is nothing to stop you. You can actually produce all sorts of connections of vectors, but now the mathematics itself, what does it function now? Except, as I said, as a language. And I put it in the text, but I hope this will get published, that you can describe a train accident in English, in French, and it's still the same train accident. So the mathematics is just a way of describing the train accident, and he goes on with it. Now, when we do that, we can see that he has finished At-Takmila, he has finished the Muntaha al-Idrak with all the new additions into them, and now he is going to begin to head to the solution of Hal Ma La Yanhal, which he aimed at it from the very beginning to become a small textbook, but not for the introductory students of astronomy, for the advanced degree, or for the experts in astronomy who actually now want the juiced out mathematics to be able to solve all the problems that were not solved by earlier astronomers. Now he wants to do it. Now you will understand, I hope you will appreciate the pains I had to go through to figure out what did he do with this Hal Ma La Yanhal and how he did it. The first manuscript, by sheer luck, by the way, I believe in providence, definitely. There is luck that comes, it's just like a guardian angel that sits on your shoulder and says, he drives you, he says, go there, go there, go there, oops, and then all of a sudden, sitting at the Bibliothèque Orientale in Beirut, bored, nothing to do, a whole afternoon, so I said, let me look at a manuscript, and this manuscript came to my attention, and notice, the manuscript is in a very poor shape, because even the title is called Kitab Ilm al-Hay'a, which is not Kitab Ilm al-Hay'a, actually, I will show you that it is indeed a copy of Hal Ma La Yanhal. And then the copyist wrote first Kitab Ilm al-Hay'a, then Thumma Kitab Fit Tub, which is obviously bad cataloging. There is no Tub that follows it. That's just a Kitab like that. And then as you look at it here, he really, the copyist, did not know what he was copying. And he goes in, Subhanaka ya dhal arsh al-a'la, wa ya ajal. No, it is wa ma ajalla sultanaka. Now is read as wa ya because he saw the first ya, he copies the second ya. And then he goes on, yeah, yeah, all of holy tabul. So this is a scribe who really doesn't know what he is copying. This should teach us a lesson. Don't ever pay somebody and ask them to go and copy a book for you because they don't know what they are copying. They are only doing it for the money. You should be able to do it yourself if you can, and the copy will be at least will render the original content. This is the manuscript that I fell on the very first time. And it befuddled me because, as I said, not only the mistakes, it's not the intended manuscript, and I didn't know what to do with it. Because again, look what he did here. When he came to the author, he says, "Fayaqul al-faqir ila Allah al-ghani Muhammad ibn Ahmad al-Jathri." The original owner of this manuscript, may his soul also rest in peace, Pir Louis Sheikhou, who was the founder, by the way, of the Bibliothèque Orientale, a nice Jesuit. That Pir Sheikhou owned this manuscript, and he was the one who actually copied the name Jaffri from this one into his own catalog. So the catalog of the Bibliothèque Orientale in Beirut does not contain Khafri. There is no Khafri. There is a Jaffri. Now, we all know the term Jaffri, by the way, rings all sorts of things from Ilm al-Jafr and the Ali ibn Abi Talib Jafr, and the Jafar that the Ahl al-Bayt are endowed with, all of this. So it is possible that somebody like Shaykhu, who thought, this is a guy who plays with Jafar. And then we know that Jafar is almost a kind of prognostication, a kind of looking into the future, but you have to have a divine inspiration to be able to do that. So it misleads the reader from the catalog. The catalog reader will never look at this text as an astronomical text. He would say it's Jafar. You see? And when we see Jafar, we all know what it is, and hence we will disregard. But all of this because the scribe made a mistake of the Kha with the dot above, turned it into Jim with the dot below. So we all know how these things happen, and the poor guy misled. Now, in order to confirm that I am not on a goose chase, that indeed there was a text that was not called Kitab al-Malaya, but really called Hal Ma La Yanhal. I was lucky enough, and with my good connections with few friends in Iran, may they live very, very long, and stay, you know, much, much longer after I pass away, I asked them to send me copies of what they have in Iran. And from Danishgahi Ferdowsi here, Ilahiyat 726, it reads here, Risalat Hal Ma La Yanhal, which is perfect. That's what I wanted. But then haram, again, you should be very, very sympathetic to the scribes. Paper was expensive. Still, no matter how cheap it was very expensive. So you squeeze on the page as much as you can. And he has really here, Risalat Hal Ma La Yanhal, من مسائل الهيئة لشمس الدين محمد الخافري with the dot on Khafri, because in Iran the guy knows where Khafri is and he doesn't think it is Jafar. So he knows that this is in the area of Fars. So he says here, but look, the guy wanted to save space, so he puts Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim between those two. But we all know how to jump over these things. We know what he's intending to do. And he goes on to make sure that this is exactly the text that we are talking about. He says again, سبحانك يا ذا العرش الأعلى وما أجل سلطانك يا قيوم السماوات العلى صل. This is exactly the same text we saw at the Bibliotheque Orientale. That's the incipit. Now, I am confirmed that this is the same text that should have been called at the Bibliothèque Nationale by Sheikhu himself, that this is the book of Hal Ma La Yanhal. Now, to be sure that I was not also in a goose chase, at the very end, there is such a thing that's called colophons. At the very end, he says also, Tammat Risalatu Hal Ma La Yanhal. That is perfect. So it confirms it once more that it is. And then also, قَدْ تَمَّ هَذِي. Again, the Persians have a problem with masculine, feminine, by the way. It's okay. It's all right. We like that. Everything is U. Okay, he says, قَدْ تَمَّ هَذِهِ الرِّسَالَةِ الشَّرِيفَةِ فِي يَدِ أَفْقَرِ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ أَلْغَنِيْتَ التَّطَعِ. He gives us his name and he gives us the date. So we have it all perfectly that this copy that is at Danishgah Ferdowsi is still the copy of the Hal Ma La Yanhal, confirmed with the beginning, confirmed with the colophon. So we know exactly that this is the text that we have to play with. And I will show you when you come to play with it what will happen. This is the kind of text that we have. Dense, saving every inch of the paper. Text after text after text. No space to explain. Nothing except every now and then he will underline a few things because he thinks that these are important. To just break the monotony of the page. But this is the kind of text from the Danishgah. And you think if this is difficult, you have not seen anything. This is the text that comes from the same text again. Subhanaka ya dhal arsh. Wa ma ajalla sultanaka ya qayyum as-samawat. This is the very same text, but it comes from the National Library of Russia, from St. Petersburg. And again, you should be very sympathetic for people who could not have enough money to buy the best paper that they have. It is written on a very thin paper that is almost semi-transparent, so that it, just to give you a taste what will happen on the, this is the first page because there is nothing written on the back of it, so you can read it. It's easy. Look at this page. So for those of you who pray, I want you to pray an extra prayer for me and for my soul after I die, because I managed to go through all of this to figure out what was Khafri saying in the process. This is the kind of commentaries that contain some of the most ingenious mathematics. And that to say that books cannot be judged by their looks, okay? This is a good example. You should go into the text and then you will see that he has all sorts of things. The Danishgah is a copy, now states it out explicitly. He is in the mode of saying aqul. So he says here, ma tafarradtu bistinbatihi, meaning this solution for the upper planets. He says, this is my creation. It is neither Tusi, nor Sharif al-Zirjani, nor anybody. This is tafarradtu. When somebody speaks like this, he begins to sound like he is a little bit audacious. But the humility later on will cover all of that. You see, it's ultra human. But at the same time, he doesn't want you to say disregard it. This is something totally new, and he produced ma tafarradtu bistinbatihi, as you see here. And then when he reached the upper planet, I mean the spheres of the moon, which he discusses in al-Maqsad al-Khamis fi aflak al-qamar wa harakat, he says, this, the moon, the spheres, لا تنتظم الأمور المذكورة إلا بخمسة أفلاك على كل من هيئتنا وهيئة الصاحب. He means صاحب التذكرة والتحفة. Now he's saying, I produced a new astronomy that requires five spheres for the movement of the Mercury, but my astronomy is similar, not the same. It is similar to that of صاحب التذكرة, which is Tusi, صاحب التحفة, that is Qutbuddin al-Shirazi. So now he's saying, I am on equal playing fields with these guys. I am producing new astronomy, new mathematics, and you better look on what I am doing. I goes on in this when he reached the position of what is, by the way, this point here in the Greek text is translated into Arabic as Ishkal al-Muhadat, which is a problem. The Muhadat is prosnoisis in the Greek, which is a very problematic thing in the Ptolemaic text itself. It is almost like measuring things from a moving target. The target is constantly moving and you have to measure things from the moving thing. All astronomers who saw this point in the Greek text, they said it is impossible. That is an Ishkal. Ishkal meaning a problem, something that we will actually will not be able to live with it. And then he says at the end, when he finishes it, hal this, he says, halluhu min al muhalat. So to remind you that he is going to write a book called hal ma la yanhal. What you think is muhal, that cannot be solved, I'm going to solve it for you. And then he shows you how he did it for the, and then he says, when he knew exactly that he is confident now, he is producing astronomy of the highest order. He says, إِنَّ إِدْرَاكَ مِثْلَ هَذِي الْأَمْرِ الْجَلِيلِ إِلَى حَدٍ مِنَ الْقُوَى الْبَشَرِيَةِ يُضَاهِي السِّحْرِ وَيُحَاكِي الْإِعْجَازِ. You see, this is exactly, I say, the triumph of a mathematician when you solve the problem. And the best example I can give you, how a mathematician feels when you solve the problem. Imagine if Napoleon had won Waterloo. Imagine the victory. Imagine the sense of excitement. And this guy is saying, now I have solved something that is very, very close to miraculous, which is really saying that he is solving what could not have been solved before. So he's introducing you to the next book that he is going to write. And then at the end of it, he says, فَهَذِهِ أَرْبَعَةُ أَوْجُهِنْ. Like in the case of Mercury, he gives you four different solutions. He says, for the muhadat, I can give you also four that can actually solve it. But then notice what he does to teach us that mathematics is not a unique road. Mathematics is like any other language. He says, وَاخْتِيَارُ أَحَدِيَا مَوْكُولٌ إِلَى نَاظِرِي الْكِتَابِ. I leave it up to you. You choose. There is no golden truth in the solutions in mathematics. Mathematics is equivalent. You just choose which vector connections you like more and they fit your purposes. So he's leaving it to the reader. So the reader is engaged and the reader now is irked a little bit to produce better, to actually do things a little bit better than that. And then he says in here, in the next one, when he has finished in the hal ma la yanhal, he goes back to the Mercury models. He disregards this one and he disregards it and keeps only those two. We have seen that the last one in here, which is the fourth model, is attributed to Qushji, and Khafri himself did not claim it as his own. So in the final textbook, he doesn't want to call it his own, so he leaves it as honestly to say the rest is his own production. And this one, I have to tell you why he probably dismissed it. When I tried to figure out what he was doing, with no diagrams, but they had no diagrams whatsoever. He only had those dense texts. I tried to figure out how was he describing all those motions. It took me literally for 1.5 pages, it took me 2.5 years to actually figure out which sphere is moving at which angle and which complementing sphere is moving on the other angle. It is extremely, extremely difficult, and it requires the astronomer to actually begin to come to terms in his period. He died in 1550, to come to terms with the idea of vectors. For those who probably the word vector doesn't mean very much. Vector is different from the quantities in the sense that it is directional. So you can take 2 centimeters going this way, take them here too, and it's still the same thing because you're going in the same vector. Proportions. So that kind of gymnastics that you play with the mathematics, he probably felt it is too difficult for the students. So he dismisses it. This one cuts it out. This one is not his. And he keeps with those two. Those two, he thinks that they are, first they are his and they are excellent solutions for the planet Mercury. And then he says, فَهَذَانِ الْوَجَانِ أَلَّذَانِ, that's the translation here, يَنْحَلُّ بهما الإشكال المتعلق بمعدل مسير عطارد وعدد أفلاك كل منها ستة في غاية الحسن. They are beautiful solutions. غاية الحسن. Look at that. And then he said, قد أنعمها الله تعالى علي والحمد لله على أفضاله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ورسوله وآله. So now, see these guys, when they get a gift, by the way, in another book he says, and I work by the advice from the Quran, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. He says, when you get a gift, you should really go and pronounce it and tell about it so that the power that gave it to you will also be acknowledged. So now he says, this is أَنْعَمَهَا اللَّهُ عَلَيَّ. And now he's humbly saying, if it were not for that grace of God, I could not knock my head against God. If God did not give it to me, I would not have solved it and would not have reached. Now I want to reach the questions that and conclude with them. Why were these commentaries well not well appreciated before? Not that many people actually talked about them, or just like Mr. Madkur dismissed them. And they said these are verbiage over verbiage. And not, I hope that you have seen they are not verbiage. They are all sorts of new things in them, but nobody had looked at. My suspicion is that first, they are very difficult to read, as you have seen in this, or you have seen in this. Those are not something that you roll your sleeve and get excited about it and say, let us delve into them. This you do them only if there is a fire in your belly saying, if people are saying the period after Ghazali is all dead, they must be wrong. When that many people say the same thing, definitely it is wrong. You should go and swim against the current so that you will see that there is something that they really have not seen it. Now we can see the difficulty of those texts really was a hindrance to them, as we can see. Second suggestion, why is it that all of those texts that Khafri had written are densely written texts? And that introduces us a little bit on the production of manuscripts in Islamic civilization. The production of manuscripts assumed three things from the very beginning. You need an author. If there is no author, there is no book. You need an author to write an autograph copy or to dictate the copy to his students. You need that first movement of it. Second, you need from that author, you need a good scribe to take it down in dictation or to copy from somebody else. As we have seen, the scribe actually messed it up in the Bibliotheca Orientale. If it is a mathematical text, you need a third thing. You need somebody to illustrate it for you. Illustrations are very difficult, as you have seen it. I told you it took me 2.5 years to figure out one illustration. Who's going to spend that much time? Thanks to me, I mean, other were paying my salary, so I could do it. But people usually don't do that. So that idea that you have to have a text, you have to have it illustrated. Usually I have seen several manuscripts. What they will do, they will fill where the scribe is copying, and then they will leave a little spot in the page for the illustrator to come and fill it later. So it required two people, at least a copyist and an illustrator to fill it up there right next to it. And hence, if you are an author, you are at the... By the way, when we send our books to the printer these days, and the printer tries to illustrate them, very often he will put the picture in the wrong place. And that have happened to me several times. And very often, actually, that picture is reproduced usually by better software and that, and it messes the picture. So you have to rely on so many people to get your ideas across. So if you are a genuine author and you really care about spreading your word, you write it in the best language you can, without reliance on anybody else. So you describe it from the very beginning in good Arabic, in excellent flowing, and making absolutely sure that you draw the attention of the reader to every single minute so that at the very end, the text can stand for itself without the need of an illustrator. It is very rare indeed to find a manuscript that happens to be written and illustrated by the very same man. And thanks to my very, very good friends at the British Library, there is one such manuscript right here in the British Library, which is an illustrated text of the famous Dioscorides translated into Arabic, which of course needs, in principle, somebody to write the text, somebody to draw the paintings in it. And not everybody can scribble those paintings, except that this very same manuscript, by the way, there is another one like it. I don't have the pictures of it, but this one shows you exactly what I mean. At the very last page in here, the text ends with Tammat al-Maqala al-Rabi'ah. Here, I enlarge it a little bit. And what does it say here? Tammat al-Maqala al-Rabi'ah min Dioscorides min naskhiha wa naqshiha. The term naqsh is very important because now it means naqsh is the same thing as rasm. It is actually producing the picture. So he says, now taha min naskhiha wa naqshiha. He drew both of them. Of course, يوم الخميس عشر ربيع الأول من سنة 35 هجرية على يد العبد الضعيف. See how pious and how humble the... He doesn't even mention his name. He is العبد الضعيف الحج النقاش. That's how they know him in the bazaar. They know he is the نقاش. This is the guy who paints. But he copies as well as paints. And then he says, النقاش في مدينة السلام ببغداد حامدا ومصليا ومسلما. So this is probably the only daring person who decided to take the text and to draw the pictures as well. As I said, there is only one other that I know of, and I have seen by now thousands of manuscripts. And I have seen blank pages or blank spots on the page waiting for a painter to come and actually finish them up. So these difficulties actually, I think, has persuaded people not to look into these comments. But more importantly, I think, it is the statements that I started with that were copied by Ibrahim Madkur without thinking. I think at the time when he made that statement, he really was not aware of the commentaries that much. That they frame our minds. They have told us not to look for novelty in anything done after the 12th century. And the frame of mind with which we read a book is determinant on what we read in the book. It becomes a result of our friend. I think I bored you enough. But you should be grateful that I didn't read. If I read this text, you would have fallen asleep by now. Thank you very much.
Initially, I would like to pray and ask all of us actually to pray for Professor Saliba for even longer life. More successes, more patience, and even greater, achievements in the future to enlighten us with such enormous results, scientific ones. So thanks a lot. It was a great honor and pleasure to have him tonight here. Thank you very much. Now is the time for questions, and so please.
You gave us something which I cannot find words to praise, thank you for feeding us with something immensely intellectually rich. So thank you very much. But let me tell you something which has puzzled me. You told us that Islamic science was very advanced long after the end of the golden age of Islam, the so-called golden age of Islam. But what puzzles me is that was it the case that the same advancement was being replicated in other aspects of the Islamic civilization? What I have in mind is specifically Islamic philosophy. As you know better than me, Islamic philosophy took another turn. It moved away from a rational approach towards a more theosophical approach. And when, for example, you come to the period of Safavid dynasty, and you come across a great scientist like Sheikh Baha'i, despite the fact that the man is an adept astronomer, mathematician, and faqih, and expert in other fields, when he writes his volume of poetry, he pours a scorn upon himself and what he has done in this scientific field, and he says that I have completely wasted my time and I have not should made myself involved in those things, and by making those ideas available to the masses, he actually suggesting to them that getting involved in scientific activities is not a suitable pursuit. Now, my question is this. Why was it that this sort of disjoint, this sort of disconnect could be seen in our civilization? And don't you think that as a result of that disconnect, and as a result of ascendancy of some other non-scientific fields, like, for example, fiqh. As you know, fuqaha got the upper hand, and they became the most authoritative figures in the whole Islamic culture.
I got the message. I understand which is it's very good to even think along that. That brings to mind a very interesting figure by the name of Ibn Hazm, Andalusian, from the 11th century, who wrote a text that's called Maratib al-Ulum. He raises the very same question. What is the purpose of Ulum? Why do we study everything we study? And then he builds a hierarchy for them. At the very end, it's the salvation of our soul.
Yeah.
All of this is mundane things, they come and disappear. But the salvation of our soul is there. And Tusi is in the same mode. By the way, Khafri, with all of this brilliant mathematics, if you look at the texts of Al-Dhari'a fi Ulama'i Shia, they mention Khafri theological works and philosophical works, and then he wrote the Takmila. To them, I mean, the Takmila is a trivial thing. Because again, it depends on who is approaching the subject, what is your purpose of looking at this material, what do you think you're achieving with it at the very end. Now, I will not go as far as say that this bifurcated the culture. This Khafri, by the way, was a great faqih at the same time. Remember when these fuqaha from Jabal Amid, they come to south of Iran at the time of Shah Abbas.
Yeah,
and he asked them, who were the people who were giving you the fatwa? They say, Khafri. And he says, good, stay with him. This guy was interpreting the religion correctly. So these guys, they did not see themselves on Sunday going to church or Friday going to the mosque and on Thursday working in the lab. They saw themselves as continuous human beings, and human beings are complex. They have religious ideas, they have mathematical ideas, they have astronomical ideas. They even sometimes write poetry. How many people did not write poetry? If you haven't written a line of poetry when you were 13, 14, you have wasted your childhood. Everybody involves in these kinds of things. So what I'm objecting to, not your statement, what I'm objecting to is people try to see only the mathematics or only the astronomy or only the fiqh or only the tariq or only the sirah. The cultures don't live like that. They spill over. When he's talking about things, you have other ideas in the place, and then you get all sorts of inspirations.
Okay,
but
thank you.
It is a very good remark on that.
Okay,
we know each other from years back. Good to see you. Good to see you. Okay, Hamdani, how are you doing?
Okay, please, if you
ask you about the patronage of these scholars.
Who is we paying
are,
them to
we
live?
Are in the time of decline, political decline, and did the patrons understand what the scholars were producing and patronizing them or not?
I would actually love to go into this, except that it will take a whole different lecture by itself. Patronage is a very thorny issue. Most people think because we have the figure of somebody like Al-Ma'mun or Al-Mutawakkil, who actually employed a lot of people, that means all the scientists were very happy they were getting paid. No, patronage even then was always very difficult to get. It was not easy to get, as it is not easy today. For those of us who are applying for grants every year or every time we can get a chance, we all know the bitter disappointment when we don't get them. Also, it is very rare that we find a patron who is knowledgeable enough to actually figure out the person to whom he is giving the money, what are they doing with it? The only patron and politician and potentate that I know of is none other Ulugh-Beg. Ulugh-Beg of Uzbekistan, he was the one who actually not only patronized the building of a school in Samarkand, not only built an observatory, he used to take 2 days off per week and go to the school and sit with the students who were studying astronomy. And he will ask them, as the student is reading and commenting, stop at this one, explain it to me. And we have this from the people who were recording their commentaries as he was there. All the others, political success does not imply money and does not translate into flourishing the society. As we all know, money by itself, by the way, also does not produce a tremendous uplifting of education if it's not well spent, if it's not advisedly done, and if it doesn't, it's not taken over by the market. Market forces work against intellectual production. I don't think if I apply for a grant to study all those commentaries, I don't think there is any single government who will give me money for it.
Okay,
despite their value, despite how important they are, people don't. Nobody will patronize this activity. But it's a pleasure for me to decipher it.
Thank you, Professor. Whoever asks if you can present yourself, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Yahya Bayzon from the Institute of Ismaili Studies.
Thank you. Here in London?
Yes, in London. Yes. Thank you very much for a wonderful lecture, and it was a great lesson for us young scholars as well, how to approach manuscripts with that such type of difficulties. Since my field is education, I'm going to ask a question and your comment about from the educational perspective. I'm interested to see your view how and where we can see the relevance and implication of your work and also similar works in the field of education, not just to leave it as a history of science, but to say something to make it more contemporary and relevant.
Nobody reads me, don't worry about it. People are busy trying to struggle in the market to make money. No, it has tremendous implications, of course, as you can see. If people reading this attentively, if they can actually begin to think that every single book is at least worth reading before you throw it away, you should at least read the damn thing. Okay, and then if you want to throw it away, that's fine. But the framing of the mind, as I said earlier, if you frame the mind of people that nothing is written important after 12th century, then they will stop reading. We were all under that impression. When I started working on these things, I was the same impressions as Madhkur was. But now, the more I read, the more I feel that I have to backstep and then rethink all of these things. And now it's leading to all sorts of new things. Difficult, unpatronized, nobody helps. But that's okay. I'm not complaining to you, but that's all right. If you can, you know, if you want, I give you my account, you can put money in it. But that's not.
Thank you, Dr. Ahdash.
Muhammad Ahdash, the Muslim College. Thank you very much for this lecture. I would like to say about the statement made by Ibrahim Madhkur.
Yes.
As far as I know, it is not his statement. Actually, it runs before that. It is made originally by Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, firstly. Then runs from there up to now. And as far as I know, the first one challenged this statement is Zahid Kauthari, then Abu Ghadda, then Bhuti. Another statement which I would like.
There is no end to the names of people who have been colonized. Their minds were colonized. There is no end.
If we ride the time machine suggested by my friend, that of Tusi now applied to the court against Copernicus by stealing his idea, because the title is Originality. How to define originality? How to define the role of commentary? Because we have to have the mindset at that time, which is that we keep the original text, and as I am a student, I will just add my additions, but to keep this name uplifted. So this is the idea, and it must be taken by the system of education, how they run. They put the sheikh or the first author in the beginning. Thank you very much.
Okay. Dr. Dubayan, then Yasmin. Sorry, Yasmin.
Tusi, that's why Tusi, you know, went through the whole, about 150 pages, speaking what Al-Fadl Batlamyus was saying. And by the way, not Batlamyus. Stop writing Batlamyus. There is no Batlamyus. There is Batlamyus at best because it's transliterating Ptolemaeus. Okay? Keep that. And everybody keeps writing, especially newspaper people, they keep writing Batlimazor. Now, he goes with Al-Fadil, Al-Jaleel. They speak of him with tremendous respect. But then at the very end, when they find a mistake, it is an insult to keep it. So he says, Aqul, now you have to stay. That doesn't make sense. So you have to stop it. And similarly, we've seen Khafri with all his tawadar. He said, these are gifts from God. I mean, he doesn't go wax proud, except a few times he said, look at it, this is almost miraculous to produce this material.
Thank you. Yeah, Dr. Ahmed. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ahmed Dubayan, the director of the Islamic Cultural Center here in London. I'm so happy to be here, Dr. Professor, and thank you very much for this really marvelous time. I wish really you had...
No, it's on. It's
okay.
On. And
it's okay. Okay, let's go. Yeah. I wish really you had more time, really, to let us more enjoy, really, about the knowledge you have. My question, I have two things. One question and another one is a small suggestion.
Okay.
Yeah, for us it was short.
You don't want
really.
Me to keep walking around.
Okay. The question is, you have given us two examples of these commentaries. Is that really, that is, you have seen more examples of these commentaries, so we can generalize this to say the judgment made by Madkur and others was unfair? Or just two or three or four examples are not enough to say that is our judgment for a whole era?
That's a very good question. And I tell you the reason why. I wrote a book that was published by NYU in 1994 that I called it A History of Arabic Astronomy, and then Planetary Theories in the plural during the Golden Age of Islam, Golden Age of after Ghazali. So I punned in every single
yes.
one of those words. And then I give a series of new planetary theories, all of them extracted out of commentaries. So you can actually see abundance. Actually, I dare say, and by the way, in the written text, when this talk will get published, I hope, in the written text, I even explain why commentaries were written in the first place. You write the commentaries because at that time, you didn't have a specialized scientific journal to which you send your new article as a new idea. There were no journals. The first journals actually were born in this country in the 17th century, the scientific journals. So what you do, you write your commentary, and at the point where you are contributing new thing, you write your article. And then after, exactly as Khafri done, after you have written several of those articles, you group them together and you write the textbook. This is how scientists actually work up till this very day. Textbooks are not born as textbooks. They're usually born as bright ideas, published in a journal, discussed by other colleagues, and then responded to by other, and then at the very end you juice them, and then you write a textbook that becomes common knowledge that everybody accepts.
Yes.
This is how commentaries actually work. And I think during that period, they did one thing that is better than what now specialized journals do. When you publish an article in a specialized journal nowadays, people will read that article on its own. It has only the quotations of the earlier people who have worked on it. But it doesn't re-put that idea in the context where the discussion has arisen in the first place. In the commentaries, they keep everything together. So you have a body. Why Tusi gets so enervated with Ptolemy at the very end to say Aqul? But you get to that only after you have seen how much he has learned from Ptolemy. So he was not insulting Ptolemy. He was actually learning, paying tribute to him and all of that. And then at the very end, when he had to say his new idea, he says it. Now he has a new idea. Then 10 years later, he goes and produces a Tadhkira, which is new novelty. It is not a commentary. And he writes it in there and he brings the new idea and now embeds it in the new context. So this is exactly how science functioned then and how it functions now, with one difference, Iota. Yet they didn't have scientific journals.
Yes.
We do.
Yes. The suggestion is a very small, actually. It's about one word in Arabic, actually, about the title of the book, At-Tuhfatu Shahiyya. No, At-Tuhfatu Shahiyya.
Yeah.
It was written with alif and with long a. Is it a shahiyya or a shahiyya? It is written as Shahiyah.
It is Shahiyah.
From Shah. That's the question, yes. Yes. It's not Shahiyah.
Shah of the Shah of the
Shah.
Yeah,
exactly.
And of course,
okay.
If you are writing and hoping for patronage to get some money,
yeah,
you
have
call
to write Shahiyah.
You are the Shah of the Shah.
That's why, yeah.
And then you will call him Malik al-Arabi wal-Ajam. And then all of you, hopefully they will pay you. But
okay.
Most of those Shahs, they don't pay you.
Yasmin, yes. Then lady, then
yeah, right, it
Malik.
Was Shahiyah. I would have loved that. Oh. It would have tickled your stomach too if it was Shahiyah. No, it is the Shahiyah.
Hello, thank you.
Please.
I have a
especially,
question.
Especially, you see, my ear doctor says you should never listen to women because their pitch is very. So you have to speak loud and assert yourself so that they can hear you.
Yasmin Farid, Cambridge University Library. I have a question on the transition of the texts. The one. Am I right in assuming, also according to the date in the colophon and the date of his flourishing, were there autograph manuscripts that you found in Iran at the Ferdus, or did you find any autograph manuscripts? Because they were quite close to his lifetime.
Sure. You mean autograph manuscripts are very rare. They are rarer than the Black Swan. It is very rare. They will all, a good number of manuscripts will say nasakhtuhu min khatti mu'allifihi, meaning they have seen an autograph before. But the minute you nasakhtuhu, you introduce mistakes. And I always tell my students, if you don't believe that the scribes make mistakes, no matter how many times they swear that they copied the original autograph and all that, I ask you to write a letter to your dearest person, to your mother, and then leave it in your drawer. 2 days later, copy that letter and leave it in the drawer. 3 days later, compare the two, and you will find in the copy you made mistakes, even though you are the author. So copying is, by its very nature, a trickery thing. I mean, the eye slips, our vision slips, our mind slips. We insert things that are not in the text because all of these things are there. People who play with manuscripts, they know all of this. So it's not a problem to them. But in terms of physical existence of autographed manuscripts by famous authors, the only one I know of, and here is my occasion, and I hope you keep the tape alive. The only one that I know of, and I have a microfilm copy of it, by the hand of Qutbuddin Shirazi, the same Qutbuddin Shirazi. He wrote his Tuhfa Shahiyah in his own hand, and it was kept at the Awqaf Library in Baghdad. When 2003 liberated Baghdad, it liberated this manuscript from the existence into dust. This is the only autograph that I know of, and I think I'm the only one who still have the microfilm of it. It went into smokes. So they are so rare, extremely rare, to find them, but they do exist. Yeah.
Okay, the next question, please.
Every single manuscript is worth reading with fresh eyes. I like that.
Every single word?
You said every single manuscript is worth reading.
At least.
With fresh eyes, which yes. Is fantastic. Thank you very much for that. Since you started your lecture with historiography, yes. If I may be cheeky enough to ask you about, to comment on the works of Professor Dimitri Gustas.
Yes. By the way, I call him Ghuttas.
Probably you're right. And
no, he is Ghuttas. He's not Ghuttas, but I call him Ghuttas. That's okay.
And especially where it concerns patronage.
Yes.
And where it concerns the Greek, how Arabs yes. dealt with Greek knowledge. And I'll end up with a message of support with my Iranian friend at the back there, because if history is changes and continuities, yes. Some sciences, some disciplines seem to have suffered, even though that you brilliantly showed us that sciences didn't. Thank you very much.
Sure. No, that's very good. First, I pay tribute and three hugs to my very dear friend Dimitri Gutas. He's a very close friend. I admire his work. I've always admired his work. And it's brilliant what he has done. And it's how much more praise I can put to it. Of course, as I said, the field of patronage, the field of transmission, the field who was reading what and when, And all we have, for example, I mean, from that same period in the 9th century, we have the text of the famous Hunayn ibn Ishaq, the translator of the Greek material into Arabic. He gives us a list of 129 books of Galen that he translated into Arabic. And he tells us the circumstances under which he translated one. So you can see the poor kind of condition that he worked, despite the fact that he was patronized. But then if you look at his biography in Ibn Abi Usaybi'ah, where he speaks of the shada'id wa masa'ib allati alammat bi min ahli jildati, he says, from my own friends who have actually scandalized me, did this, did that. So you can see their lives was not very easy. So meaning, we can read them with different prisons. And there are also, depends on what are you paying attention to. The patrons were not always beneficiaries. I mean, they were benevolent. The patrons also threw Hunayn ibn Ishaq in jail because, you know, people who were jealous from him, they accused him of all sorts of things. So why we read them, who was paying the money, what was the social history of all of these things is not yet written. We need to write it. And we should, at least I beg you, we should stop writing politicalist, meaning political. وَفِي الْخَلِيفَةِ فُلَانْ قَضَى عَلَى فُلَانْ وَقَتَلَ فُلَانْ. Now this is not history, please. And we should move into the causes, the social factors, the economics, the conditions of the society, so that we write it and give flesh to these kinds of texts. All I'm advising at this stage, read. وَقْرَى. That's all.
Malik, please.
Malik Dahlan, I'm an enthusiast about law and Islamic political thought. Also, this is my plug-in for another important part of what Al-Furqan does, which is the Maqasid Center.
Yes.
And the same claim, as you know, Professor, has been made about how the fiqh has been stagnant for a long time.
My very dear friend Ridwan Sayyid should be listened to. People should listen to
him. I'm actually, funny you mention him. I never, you know, the first manuscript I looked at, and I really hate manuscripts. I hate looking at them. They're very difficult. They're very hard. So I pray for you.
To listen to you.
I pray for you. I pray for Al-Furqan because it's extremely difficult.
I will never mention you in my prayers.
I will mention you in mine. I reflect on Al-Tusi's original, or at least I remember what I remember the most of Tusi's work was the Risalati Nasir. Hmm. And in that sense, it's more about ethics and covering Islamic thought. And that's
Akhlaqi Nasiri.
And then he has the Risala Starlab, which was the thing that I knew about that had to do with science.
The guy was a full brain.
But how do you see that? You're just looking at that manuscript. How do you actually, you mentioned the sort of multidisciplinary approach.
Yes.
That they would have. But have you looked at the Akhlaqi Nasiri and how approach similar?
I have. Thank you. I only followed Ibn Sina's advice. Ibn Sina was asked, how do you determine a good book that you should waste your time to read it from a book that you should dismiss? He says, I take the book and I look at the section of the book that I know very well. And if the author seems to be treating it fairly, then I read it because it's an intelligent author. Otherwise, I dismiss the book. I did the same thing. Meaning, when I need things, take it as I need it. You see, when I need it, yes, I go and look into the fiqh material. For example, I wanted to explain why people in the later periods, meaning in this century that we are talking about, why did they come into decline? And again, I have different interpretations of all of these things. And then I encountered the concept of which developed in Europe and became fundamental to modern science, the concept of patenting your ideas, i.e. to get an idea, first keep it as a secret, two, turn it into a monopoly, third, make it into economic gains. That guy, then we began to worry as to why other cultures did not do that. And then it turned out, and that I learned from Dimitri Guttas, who is this question who asked about Guttas. I learned it from Guttas because he had delivered a speech, the paper once at Columbia, and that he called it Ad-Dannu Bil-Ilm. which is a beautiful concept to understand it, what it is. And then if you really bring that Dimitri paper on Ad-Dhanna Bil-Ilm, and if you bring together from the hadith, من علم علما وظن به على أخيه المؤمن جاء يوم القيامة ملجما بلجام من نار. What else do you want? So you can see from the hadith, you have a justification now as to why you are under obligation, under legal obligation now, under religious obligation, ethical obligation, if you know something, to spread it. وَبِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. See, that is in the mind of Khafri. It is in the minds of those people. So the religious feelings, the legal feelings, the construction, people are complex societies, complex human beings. And of course, they have a little bit of this, a little bit, depending on what aspect of them are you reading. Tusi, of course, was aware. So was Ibn Hazm, by the way. So was Khafri. He was in his spare time. Khafri was sitting there adjudicating Shia law. He was creating Shiite law as he grew. While Shah Abbas was worried on how to make sure that all the ulama and the mufakkirin are turned into Shiites. He forced them, if you don't curse the first three caliphs, forget it. And they asked Khafri too, why, how dare you go and curse the first three caliphs? He says, Arabun a'jam la'natullahi alayhim. He wants to solve his mathematics. Meaning, what is he concerned with at the time? So all of those are obviously facets of the complex human beings who produced a complex society. The society is not trivial. It cannot be dismissed simply because some Orientalist sitting in Paris or in London and says there is nothing worth reading in literature or in Islamic civilization after the 11th century. Yeah, they can say whatever they want. Sorry about that.
Okay, we'll take one more question and I think we'll sum up with that, please.
Yeah, light it up, yes. If it becomes
okay.
Very good.
Yeah, all right. I'm Bilal Abbas. I'm a student of Islamic history at Oxford University. I'm really glad to be here today, and I would like to ask if it is the same case with other disciplines of Islamic sciences, like legal theory, like hadith studies, other disciplines. Is it the same thing, like they keep producing new things, new theories, new stuff, or just commentaries? I mean, is it different from like religious disciplines to other sciences like astronomy and mathematics?
No. See, again, there is another idea that keeps coming to my mind when people think that there was the culture excels in one thing and then disregards the other. It is most unlikely. If people were producing religious sciences, scientific sciences, all of that, it means that the culture was already embracing all of those things. And it is only, it depends on who is looking, you see, and what interest, what focus do you bring, what binoculars you look at. As you notice, by the way, this astronomer that we have talked, we have seen, he follows the same style and the same tradition as you see of the shuruh al-fuqaha. What they would put the words of the first risala, for example, or you have to look at risala al-Shafi'i, and you will find word for word, and immediately paragraph after paragraph explaining what Shafi'i intended. So it is the style of the culture, because they didn't have periodicals. They didn't have places to publish a separate article. They keep it in the context so that people embrace all of this and they understand why it was written in the first place. That, I think, to me, is a holistic way of looking through the texts at the culture at large. But never, never we should have enough audacity to generalize on the basis of two or three texts, or on the basis of 10 or 15, especially when we know, and you know, and this foundation knows, that what we really know of Islamic manuscripts, by that I mean Islamic world manuscripts, all the way stretching from Sbo in Portugal, all the way to Indonesia, and from Samarkand up in the north, or even Tataristan up in the north, all the way to southern India, there are tons and tons of manuscripts that we don't even have catalogs for them. So how dare we speak of a culture when we don't even know the tip of the iceberg. We only know very, very, very little. So whatever I say, I humbly submit to you, is based only on the 4 or 5, 6 manuscripts or more that I have been able to look at. But we should be humble to say, God only knows what else we will see. Every time I visit the British Library or the Bodleian, every page I turn, there are new things that I have not seen before or nobody else has seen before. So, careful, careful. That's good.
Actually, I would like to conclude tonight's interesting lecture and debate. Al-Furqan is trying to uncover that stretched heritage, which is all around the world. We have managed to catalog so far almost 100,000 manuscripts, and the work is continuing. But the amount of manuscripts laying around the world is much more than that, is in millions. So let's hope that with joint efforts and joint work, we can uncover and shed light into that rich and very important heritage. At the end of this insightful and very interesting lecture, a very vibrant one, I would like on behalf of you to thank once again Professor Saliba for being tonight with us. It has been a great honor and pleasure, and we hope to see him again in our future activities and hope to see you all in our future activities, hopefully. Thanks a lot and good night.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.